Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County chapter of the National Organization for Women. This is actually our 203rd show. We're beginning our 17th year, and I'm delighted to be continuing as we have. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and the entire production crew here are all members of this chapter of NOW. And we're all volunteers. No one here is paid for what we're doing. Not only the people here in the studio, the camera people, the floor manager, but also all the people in the control room. Graphics, audio, production, director. And we have day jobs, but this is a labor of love for us. And we are, as I said, starting our 17th year at it. We have a sponsor for today. Our sponsor is Jo Sippy Gora. And she's a longtime member of Morris County NOW as well. And she has a message that fits this show so well. Jo Sippy Gora reminds us that we can change the world when we recognize that women are the key to solving the world's problems. Economic problems, health problems, human rights problems. When a woman accesses education and work and health care, she can build a bustling economy in her village. And when she's admitted to political and business circles, she can shape policy to improve the lives of her family and community. It's a cycle of positive change with women at its core. And you can get more information by going to the website girleffect.org. And I hope at some point we'll put that website up so that you can get that down. We have a good show for you today. It's called Empowerment, Education, and Economic Access, Third World Women. And we will see what one person with a vision and courage to implement that vision is doing to create beauty while advancing opportunities for women in the third world. Our guest today is Erika Freund, who, armed with a Master of Social Work from NYU and a dream, has founded Mikuti. Mikuti is a company that is merging the world of fashion and jewelry with economic development. Erika Freund is partnered with a local group of women in Tanzania, and together they are creating a unique line of jewelry sourced from banana trees. This natural material is an innovative alternative to widely used synthetic materials. And the women are not only learning a marketable craft, but are changing their lives and their prospects in dramatic ways. Welcome, Erika.
Thank you so much for having me.
I'm glad you're here.
Thank you.
And I'm glad to be able to hear about your journey. And I see over in the corner of the table some of the jewelry, and I'm so eager to get a close look at it and to even get my hands on it.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
We'll get a chance to do that. But I'd like to start by inviting you to tell us a little bit about yourself, particularly how you came to this promising enterprise.
Sure.
And what were the influences, maybe influences from your childhood or from later years, that you think gave you the interest and the courage for this adventure?
And it has been an adventure, an exciting one. Thank you. I think that I've always been a very curious individual. I was really lucky to spend time abroad throughout my life, significant time abroad. I had been to Third World prior to the experience of going to Tanzania, not for this length of time and not as involved in the local community as I was this time. I also come from an entrepreneurial family. I think that I also am a bit tenacious. I think once I get an idea with something, I want to run with it.
And where did you get the idea?
Yeah, so where did the idea come to start a company made from banana trees? It's a really good question, and I'd love to tell you more about it. So last summer, I spent about 3 months in Tanzania. I was between my first and second year of graduate school getting my MSW. And I had been working with women in the United States for the past couple of years. I started working with women in prison a few years ago, writing programs to assist in the reintegration for communities. That's really how I got my foot in the door. I went into doing domestic violence work through a clinical lens. I was really involved in the social issues that were linked to women, both on a micro and a macro level. So I knew I had this chunk of time, and I had always been very curious about what it was like in Africa. I wanted to see giraffes. I wanted the experience, but I also wanted the experience of working with women on an international level. I wanted to go to a place that was as different as I could go, that was nothing like I knew, and see what that experience was like, because one of the things I found when I was working with women in the prison system was that there's a shared female experience. Regardless of our socio and economic backgrounds. So I was so curious, like, is there a global female shared experience? So that's, ooh, that's kind of one of the reasons really why I went. Mm. Yeah.
And how did you choose Tanzania?
Well, they have really great national parks. I have to tell you, it's slightly selfish in some ways, but and it's on the coast, and I wanted to see what the Indian Ocean looked like, you know, things like that. So, and geographically, it's an outlier because it's been surrounded by conflict zones, and it's relatively safe. So those were some of my reasons for choosing Tanzania.
But getting there, how did you get connected?
So I did not go through graduate school. I went on my own. I found a very small organization that was able to help me facilitate the process. They set me up with a local host family there, which ran a very small volunteer house, which housed about 10 people. And then the host family in Tanzania actually set me up with a local NGO, which means non-governmental organization, which is like a nonprofit. So I was set up to work for this NGO, but it was not what I expected, to say the least.
And how long were you there then in that summer?
I was there for 2.5 months.
And that was when you got started?
That was when I got started. That was last summer, yes. So prior to going there, none of this existed. I actually thought that I was going to be like, well, I thought when I got there that there would be a project that I would work on, and that would be it. Like, I really thought it was a one-time thing.
A project that would be given to you?
That would be given to me, yes. Like, I thought I would go there, I would be instructed. Mm-hmm. That was not the case. I basically arrived to 6 women who spoke no English, and a man who had been working with them they had started this NGO together because they wanted to do something. The women spoke no English. The man spoke somewhat English, enough to help me communicate and translate. And they asked me, they're like, well, what do you want to do? And I said, oh, I didn't realize this. but I was really lucky because I had gotten this great, you know, foundation of social work, all of these skills that I was really, really able to pull from. So,
but you still didn't know what you wanted them to do.
No. So the first thing I did, well, because I really tried my hardest to drop my Western lens, because I never would think that I could go to a place where I had no idea of the lack of economics. Access, the lack of infrastructure, and even think that I could just say, you should do this. So I really started where they were at. I asked questions through a strength perspective, through an empowerment model. I looked at their environments. You know, I spent time with them too. I spent time with their families. I got to know their children. They taught me how to make compost, and, you know, they're farmers. So they showed me their crops, and we drank a lot of tea the first couple weeks. And, you know, I sat in their homes with them and really tried to develop a relationship with them through the language barriers, through being funny, because we all know how to laugh. And and I really sat with them.
Now, their income was produced through farming.
It was.
How did you know that they would be freed up for an alternate form of income then?
Well, they told me they would. They have time, because, interesting enough, that's something we'll have to talk about, but time was one of the big challenges, was one of the biggest challenges for us. But they did. They had extra time. And also, they were really willing. They really wanted to put in the extra time, too. So, ironically, even before the kind of banana bark project started, we actually started with their crops. It was like, how can we maximize, you know, their crops that they have? And they all knew how to cook. Mm-hmm. So I emailed my family, and I was like, can I have some recipes? This is what I have, you know? So we started actually, we started with maximizing their agricultural crops. We started with a lot of education. You know, one of the biggest, their biggest concern about their lives was capital. They had no capital. They were able to grow enough food to feed their families and sell enough produce at the markets, but they were left with nothing. But I asked the question, do you know how to budget? Mm-hmm. So when we talk about education, right, they had never had anyone teach them how to budget. So that was actually one of the first things we did, was learn how to budget.
They probably didn't have sufficient money to be able to budget. They were
no, but I will say this, after we actually like really tried to create a budget, like just write things down what they spent money on, mm-hmm. they actually had a little bit of extra money. So it was just like these really random skills we started doing, and I just think it happened through listening. I do.
And then the idea of Mikuti, even the name means...
The Mikuti means dried leaf in Swahili.
Dried leaf.
Yeah, so how Mikuti happened was very serendipitous and was not in the plans at all. We spent a whole solid month after engaging them and really them feeling comfortable with me feeling comfortable with them. We spent a solid month of just doing education. And I was emailing some friends, you know, getting advice and stuff. I basically wrote this kind of training of how to start a small business. And I'll tell you, I wrote it by using shapes. So I drew a big circle because I thought like, okay, so how can I do this? How can I communicate this? You know? So I drew a really big circle and we would talk about goals. You know, what are your goals? And their goal was to really do something. So I said,
was the man interpreting for you?
He was. This man was interpreting. Yes, he was interpreting. So I drew a really big circle, and then I drew all these little circles inside of it. And I was like, so this big circle is what you want, and all of these little circles are all of you. And you got, you know, the concept of a group, it's been around historically for women. Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, historically, women have always worked in groups. So after we did that, you know, we talked about producing something. We talked about how you sell things. I mean, we even did role playing through translation, and those are all skills I learned in social work school. So we had really decided we had made jams, we had made bread.
We tried other things.
Yeah, we tried so many things because the irony is really interesting too. In East Sub-Sahara Africa, banana trees are a huge resource, and they were everywhere. And it was actually like they were my favorite things. Like when I was there, like I thought they were beautiful. They were like canopies.
Were they on public land or on private land?
Everything's really public there. I mean, it's semi-private, but really, there's not like everyone really respects each other's property.
But you would have access to.
Yeah, so it's like, for example, like if you had a tree on your property, you could do anything you want with it. So it's mm-hmm. kind of the same thing. But there's such an abundance of banana trees, it would really blow your mind. Like they're just in rows after row after each other. So we basically had decided to move forward with making jams and breads to try to sell them. And then we had talked about packaging, okay? Mm-hmm. So when you package something, you want to present. So the day we were really finalizing everything, I mean, even to the point where we went to like local supermarkets and looked at how we could sell things, I ripped a piece of bark off a banana tree, and I said, I like had this aha moment, and I was like, oh my gosh, why haven't I even done anything with this? So I started playing with it, and I was like,
this is really your idea then?
Well, it started, I mean, it was like this aha moment, you know, and then the women kind of started looking at me, and I started looking at them, and they were kind of like, and I sat there with it, and I started tying it in knots, and I was like, oh, this is interesting. But this is where it becomes very serendipitous. So somehow, through various events, I was able to find this other woman, like eight villages down, who was like this master banana weaver. Like it was unbelievable the things that she could make from this bark. I was blown away.
Is it bark or leaves?
It's both. So mm-hmm. so inside the jewelry, which I'll show
you
in a minute.
Me? Yeah.
So inside the bracelet is leaves and other parts of the tree that you maybe wouldn't use, but then it's wrapped around by the bark. So it's an actual whole process that happens.
So I hope we can get a picture of this because it's a very beautiful piece. It's a bracelet. It's in several shades of brown, even a kind of tortoiseshell
color.
Yeah,
actually every single
different
one is
shades.
Unique.
But inside is very hard. And that's part of the banana tree as mm-hmm. well. It's a very, very beautiful piece, and no two are the same. I mean, I'm looking at the other ones. They're all
different. All different colors and stuff.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah.
Just beautiful.
I love them.
Oh, you're wearing some.
I'm wearing some of those, yeah.
Wearing some on...
Some other ones, yeah. These are new additions of a... They're just a different shape.
Very narrow.
Yeah, they're just a different
shape. And they're squares?
And they're squares, and they're more of a thin bangle. This has been new this summer.
Beautiful.
Yeah, but the whole thing about this is that it wasn't in the plans in the sense of, like, so even when we started learning how to so I basically hired this woman. I paid her to come teach this women's group to learn how to weave. So they started learning how to make mats and bowls and baskets, and then... With the thought of selling them locally, which actually they do, which mm-hmm. is a really good thing, which we can get to. But so someone suggested to me, well, why don't you make a bracelet? Mm. And I was like, oh, I didn't even think about it. Like, it wasn't even in my mind frame. So I said to this woman, I said, can you make me a bracelet? She made this bracelet. And I was like, okay. And I was like, okay, so they started making bracelets. but it was funny because it was...
Did they like it?
They loved it. Yeah, I mean, they did. I mean, it's home-based, you know. I mean, they work on their property, which is beautiful grass. And, you know, I mean, it's just...
Work physically together?
They do work physically together, yeah. They really do. What we would do is we would spend about 3 to 4 hours a day together. And really, you know, they sing, they chat. Like I go and chat with my girlfriends. Like, they sit and they have a nice chat for a couple hours. And they have a laugh and a lot. We laughed a lot, you know. They made fun of me a lot, you know, in a very nurturing, affectionate way.
And were their children?
Yep, their children. I got to know their families very well. I really adore their children. Very young kids. The women are in different age ranges. Some are in their early 30s. Some of them are my age. And actually, there's two women who are quite older, like in their late 50s, early 60s. So what happened was after they made this bracelet, I was actually almost finished up there. We were able to really connect them, though, locally to start selling products, and it was something they were going to move forward with. But I was like, what am I going to do with this? You know, so I left all my clothes there, and I packed my suitcase with 100 bracelets. Yeah, and I was like, maybe I should do something. I don't know. I really didn't know. And then when I came back, I had to go back to graduate school, and I basically paid my friends to buy the first. I was like, you know, I sold them for nothing, you know, and I was like basically paid my friends
and
family.
And you sent the money back?
And so what happened was this. So I sold all of the 100 bracelets. They were not as good of a quality as they are now. That is definitely something we have worked on this past year. So this is what we did. So after I sold the 100 bracelets, I said, so we have two choices. Because it's very expensive to ship from East Sub-Saharan Africa. I said, take some of the money and pay for one box to ship, and then you take the rest and register your group there. And if you send me
at the market, register group for production.
Yeah, for production. Register your group. Send me 100 bracelets. They have to be better quality, you know. And all of this communication was through emails, through text messaging. I mean, technology has been a huge help in all of this. So, and then in the
did they have a leader? Or was it one person?
Well, this man, whose NGO, who they had worked with on and off for years.
So you communicated with him.
So he helps me a lot, and I know his family very well, and they all live in the same village. So, yeah, so I'm able to text message him. I'm able to scan in documents, email him. I mean, technology's been amazing in this. So they agreed, you know, this is definitely a partnership. So also, I started wearing the bracelets in New York City. People were, like, asking me left and right, like, where did you get those? And I was like, really? Like, I just didn't think much of it, you know? And in the midst of this, I was like, well, I guess I need to figure out a name, you know? Like, I guess I'm going to try to do this, you know? So that was last fall, and there was a lot of kind of just development work on my side, you know, trying to figure out how to start a company. Why being in graduate school was very challenging, but exciting too.
You should get credit for an independent study.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Seriously. I feel like I got a minor in economics.
Right. And business and writing business
and writing
plans.
Well, I will say this. In some ways, this is very much a very non-traditional way to start a company, and in every way possible. I would probably make someone who has an MBA squirm, but it works for us.
But it works. And you are now marketing it here.
So we are. So what happened after this is, so after I spent a lot of time thinking about this and communicating back and forth with them, because it was kind of like, do you want to do this? You know, like, because if you don't, it's okay. Like, I want to make sure if you want to do this, I want to do this. And they want to do it. So what I realized, like, if I'm going to start a company and, like, really launch a full jewelry line, I can't just have one bracelet. So I would spend my weekends and I would walk around New York City and try to figure out what I could do.
I'm just noticing you're wearing earrings.
I am.
Those are
they're Mikuti hoops.
Yep. Oh,
wow. They are. So just trying to take, you know, some very basic principles of jewelry. And I'm like, well, let me see if I can make a hoop. So I put together this package and I sent it over there, and it took a really long time to get there, and with some base metal. Like, could we maybe cover base metal with this bark? I don't know, would it take, you know? So I bought like 5 pairs of endless hoops, and I said, well, let's see what we can do. Can we make a pair of hoops? And we were able to make a great pair of hoops. I'm having a hard time keeping them in stock.
I love them.
Yeah, they've been a huge hit this summer. And that's how we were able to make these as well.
So do you market directly to the customer or through retail establishments?
So right now, we started with the hoops and these probably in about May. So we actually right now we're selling in 2 stores, which has been really exciting. There's a store in New York City that we're selling in, and we're selling in a store in Hoboken. And I'm in the process of building our e-commerce website. And, you know, it's such a learning process. I have really good people in my life that have helped me through this and are really helping me do a lot.
So that's super. How did they decide, or he with them, who would get what in terms of the income?
So I've been a little bit hands-off in that. Like, it goes back to what I was saying about, like, I don't know how to divvy resources and who needs what. And so I'm very hands-in, but I'm very hands-off, too, on certain things. They are paid beyond, more than fair trade wages for every product that we sell, that
by,
I buy
by
from
the
them.
Piece?
By the piece, yeah. It's by an order. So if I place an order for this, I pay a certain amount to them. But that's not how it was at first. At first, they really just gave me 100 bracelets, and I was like, you know. So that's what I meant when
but
I
you
said
you wouldn't know who has produced what in terms of paying them.
Oh yeah, well they've kind of have decided all of that on their own. Mm-hmm. So basically, there's a group of about 8 women now, I believe, that are working on this. Now there could be 11. I don't know, you know, but they really decide what to do with their money. And they also have like a history with one another. I mean, they've lived in the same village their whole lives. They know each other. You know, they raise each other's children, you know? So like, they're very, even when I was there, like they're very fair, you know? And like, even the gentleman who I worked very closely with, he's an incredible man. And, you know, they were very fair with each other when I was there as well. So, I mean, they have to figure that part out themselves, I think.
Right, and they're managing well, even though you're not there,
yeah.
Which is also
yeah. We were
amazing.
Able. We opened a bank account. Some of the local impact was they've opened a bank account, which is a huge, huge thing. So that was a really big mm-hmm. milestone.
You know, there's so much about this that really impresses me, and so much that's innovative. I think first of all that the materials that you're building on are all sustainable.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you're not killing any trees
no.
or any people or mm-hmm. or any. It's
free
keeps
too.
Generating itself. Mm-hmm. Yes, but it's also you're building on their culture, which I think is interesting. You've taught them skills before they started to produce,
mm-hmm.
The business skills. The social skills, and then of course the skills that was brilliant hiring that woman to teach them the skill of making the jewelry, and now you've created certainly a marketing and public relations position for yourself in all of this.
Yeah,
but is it income producing yet for you?
No, it's not. But it's okay though. I mean, ideally. I want this to be my full-time job. I mean, that would be my ideal.
You're growing into it.
Yeah,
yes.
It's been a really exciting thing for
so
me.
So are you going back then?
I am. I'm leaving in a couple weeks, actually. I'm very, very excited. I'm so excited to go back.
And how long do you expect to be there?
2.5 months. I've been taking jewelry classes. I've been taking weaving classes, so I can actually learn how to do some things. And we have a really amazing line coming out for this spring, summer of 2011. So I am very, very excited. And
you know, I went to your blog and I saw beautiful models modeling photos, beautiful models modeling the jewelry.
Yeah.
And this is the first time that I'm seeing the jewelry in person. But those are wonderful promotional photos. Could you tell us the site of your blog so that people can get in touch with you if they're interested
in
seeing more?
Yeah, sure. It's www.mikuti.blogspot.com. And if you want to ask me any questions, you can just email me at info@mikuti.com. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
And again, Mikuti is MIKUTI.
Yes.
.com.
Yes.
So you're set up with all of that.
I am set up with all of that.
How are your parents feeling about the fact that you're not making an income yet?
Well, they're used to Mikuti tags all over the dining room table and kind of a banana leaf bracelet here and there. So it's a nice family laugh sometimes.
And I bet you're amazing yourself in that all of these skills from the master's in social work could become so helpful to you.
Yeah, you know, it's been really exciting. It was not in my plans, but I'm really putting everything I have into it right now because it's fun. It's also really a lot of fun for me and has tapped into some creativity I didn't know I had. So, yeah.
And I love it for another reason, and that is that those of us who have been concerned about economic progress for third world women have tended to move into the microloan area in which an individual or a group of individuals identifies what their own needs are and then a loan is made so that they can buy something, a sewing machine, a computer, and so on. But what you've done is so totally different because you've helped them to see and to envision something that they could not have envisioned, that they would not have selected on their own.
Yeah.
And you've helped them to work together to gain.
Well, I think it's all about education. I mean, I think I can do that because I'm educated, and I think when anyone really has a good, solid education, they can think creatively.
Well, thank you so much. You have certainly enlivened our sense of what's possible in our developed relationship with the third world.
Thank you for having me.
It's a really fantastic thing that you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it. I'm assuming that we're finished.